more prone to do the ignorant things instead of the smart things. When I'm wore out, tired, I don't want to go to the gym and work out. I want to eat. You know what I mean? I know a lot of people that says, when I'm stressed out, I just want to sit in front of my computer and just search. But when we're tired, when we're wore out, when we're stressed, when there is too much idle time on our hands, we open the door and allow the enemy to come in. And a lot of times we have no clue that it's stuck the foot in the doorway of our lives. But the enemy will come in, and at that point, he will do anything he can to kill, steal, and to destroy. So here's David. David finds himself in Jerusalem. He finds himself in a place that he should not be. There's idle time. He's a king. He's a leader. He's a hands-on king, supposed to be with his men. But instead, he's finding himself in downtime with nothing to do. And we find that in that nothing to do place, there is a shift that takes place in David's life. He now goes from a hands-on king of the people who was serving the God, his God, and serving as a leader. He's gone from a hands-on king that was taking care of the people, and he goes from a servant king to a king playing God who now sends people to do his work instead of doing it himself. You know the funny thing about people who play God is the God that they play never looks like the God of the Bible. Isn't that amazing? The God of the Bible that we see is so seen in the personality of Jesus that we study so often here. The one who calls his disciples friends, who takes the job of the lowest slave or the lowest servant, and he bows, takes on the form of a servant, and washes his disciples' feet. The reason why David was called a man after God's own heart was that he had the character of God. He was a king of the people. He was a king fighting side by side with them, mourning with them when there was loss, and celebrating with them when there was celebration. Our God, the God that we serve, who is he? He is God of Emmanuel, God with us. That's why David was a man after God's own heart, because he was a king of the people and a king for the people. How many of us know people that just play God all the time? They just play God. But what we find out is David wasn't just geographically in the wrong location. We find very quickly that David was in the wrong place in his head, and David was in the wrong place in his heart. So 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 2 says this. One evening, David got up from his bed, and he walked around the roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful. Now, we're not told how long he looked. But I guarantee it wasn't a glance. And there was nothing wrong with the look. Because how many times do each and every one of us in this place have fleeting moments of thoughts that go through our mind? There's nothing wrong. We can take control over those fleeting thoughts. But when David looked upon Bathsheba, he saw something that he liked. He saw something that was very appealing to the eye. He saw something that he wanted. He looked at Bathsheba the way that I look at my wife and went, "Aruga!" He looked at Bathsheba in a way that he should have never, ever looked at her. But it wasn't the look that got him in trouble. It was the stare when he couldn't take his eyes off of her. It was the look when he couldn't peel his eyes away. It was when his gaze turned into an absolute stare, and it was a place where he opened the door for the enemy to stick his foot in his life. And all of a sudden, David, a king, a man after God's own heart was stuck in the trap of a stare, was stuck in the trap of an illusion that the enemy was saying, this could be good.
That's so good.
And David, a man after God's own heart, in an instant, let the enemy into his life, and we see very quickly that he goes from a man after God's own heart to a monster. And again, I'll say what's so horrifying about this story is it could be each and every one of us. See, the look wasn't the sin, it's what he did with the look that became the sin. His look was stealing her privacy. His lust was stealing her innocence. He was soon finding that his enjoyment of her beauty, he was stealing what should rightfully only belong to her husband. And he sees her, door open, enemy foot in, presence comes in, and he wants what he sees. Anybody ever gone into a candy shop? Let me back up. That's a bad illustration. Anybody ever gone to the Cheesecake Factory? Has anybody ever looked at red velvet cheesecake? Revival could break out in this place. You get that on your forehead, your tongue is going to beat your brains out trying to lick it off. He looked at her and he wanted what he saw. So what is the servant king who has now turned into a monster? What does he do? The servant king has had a shift in his life. He's not serving the people anymore. Now he's playing God. And just as he sent the commander Joab out with his troops, now he is sending someone out to find out who the naked woman is. So he sends them out. He's playing God. And we find that he's on this slippery slope. And how do you know that anytime you're on a slippery slope, there's always handholds and footholds where we can get off the slope? And David just keeps sliding. They come back and they say, her name is Bathsheba. And then they go on to say something that should have just rose so many flags up. And they said, he is the wife of Uriah the Hittite. We'll talk about that here in just a second. David doesn't stop himself. He looks at me and says, ooh, Bathsheba. Go get her and bring her to me. They go get her. They bring her to him. Now he's not serving his people. He's serving himself. Mm-hmm. And they bring him to her, and he sleeps with her. All is good. Isn't that how we operate with sin? That was so fun. That was so good. That was so great. That just helped me out. We do all this stuff, and we go, it was just so good. I let that moment pass, and it's amazing the guilt and the pain and the heartache that Samuel will bring. Because it's a few months later, Bathsheba now is doing this sending, and she sends a message to the palace, to the king. And she says, tell the king I'm pregnant. Dun, dun, dun! That's where everything begins to go wrong. David does the math in his head, and he goes, okay, Uriah the Hittite's been in battle for this many days, this many months, and there's no way that she could be pregnant with his child, but there's so many people that know that I had her sitting in the palace. There's a lot of servants that saw her here. They're going to do the math, and they're going to know that Uriah the Hittite's not the husband. They're going to know that I did something, and that and nobody's going to follow an adulterous king. What in the world am I going to do? Isn't it amazing how sin will put us in a place where we have to sin to get out of the sin? And we have to tell a lie to get out of the lie. And before you know, the little white lie, which there is no such thing, turns into a huge monster. And we get checked and we don't know how to get out of it. And David is on such a slippery slope, and he's sliding in the wrong direction. And what does he do? He sends word to his general, and he says, send me Uriah the Hittite. David's got a plan. Send me Uriah. He sends him Uriah, and he says, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I want to have Uriah come. I'm going to ask him about the report of the battle. Then I'm going to send him home to sleep with his wife, and all's going to be good. Good plan. Good plan. Brings him in, ask all the questions. Go home and sleep with your wife. Uriah won't do it. Uriah is going, nope. My men are in the battlefield. My men are sleeping in the field. My men are in the middle of the battle. I should be with my men. I'll have no pleasure with my men. Isn't it amazing the integrity that Uriah the Hittite had? So David calls him back the next day, and he goes, I'll get him drunk. I'll just get him drunk. David sits with him. He gets him drunk at the dinner table. He gets him all wound up and says, now that you're drunk, go home and sleep with your wife. You deserve to have a good night. Even drunk, Uriah has more integrity in his life than King David did at this moment. Because he goes and he sleeps at the city gate, and he will not go and sleep with his wife because he says, as long as my men are in battle, I need to be where my men are, and I have no pleasure at all. David looks at this, and David basically is saying, I don't know what to do. I have no clue what to do now. I thought I had this great scheme. I thought I had this cover-up. I thought he'd just come home, sleep with her. Everything would be fine. You know, they think he's the dad. I don't know what to do. So he has another scheme. He says, I'll tell you what. Writes a note to his general, and he says, Joab, put Uriah the Hittite on the front line of the most fierce battle that you've got. And when the battle gets heated, pull everybody away from him and let the enemy kill him. A man after God's own heart. On a slippery slope. Joab sins, puts him on the front line. The battle comes, the arrows fly. Many of David's men are killed. The report comes back. The report comes to the king. And they said the battle was fierce. We attacked the wall. Many arrows, swords came, and a lot of your men died. But in the report, it says this. But Uriah the Hittite was killed. David thinks at this moment that he's won. David thinks at this moment that all is good. I have fixed everything. You know what's amazing about Uriah the Hittite is Uriah is listed as one of David's mighty men. We talked about this just a few weeks back. He is in David's long list of the mighty men who were basically in his secret service, the ones that took care of him. Uriah is a foreigner serving the king with such excellence that he will do anything, even die for his king and die for his country, and he does at the hands of David. And God looks at this ugliness of sin, U-G-L-Y, you ain't got no alibi, you're just ugly. He looks at the ugliness of sin, and this is what he says. You have done this evil in the eyes of the Lord. You have done this thing in the eyes of the Lord. You ever find yourself in a place that David may be in right now? That you allowed the enemy to lie to you, and maybe you fell into a trap, maybe you fell into something that, have you ever fallen into something, you go, how did I get here? You know, we just don't wake up one day and we find ourselves in trouble. It's usually something way back here that opened the door, and we gradually find ourselves in a place of trouble. And just like you, and just like me, if you've ever felt trapped into something, if you've ever found yourself in a place like that, David now finds himself in a place where he has done this evil thing in the sight of God. The man who, the word of God says, is a man after God's own heart is now a liar. He's a thief. He stole something that doesn't belong to him. He's a fornicator. He is an adulterer. We can just go down the line of the things that we want to call him. He's sinful. Now he has committed murder. And not only is Uriah the Hittite murdered, but a lot of his other guys got killed because of his sin. He's a murderer. He is that guy that most of us would say, throw him out. He's no good. There's no help for him. He's too far gone. He's got an addiction. He's got a problem. He's got a pain. He's got a past. And it's too much for me to deal with. Get rid of him. But don't you love it that we serve a God that says, I'm never done with you.
Amen.
Don't you love it that we serve a God of the mulligan, the God of the second chances?
Amen.
The God that looked at us and said, I know where you were when you stepped into sin, and I still love you. I love you then, and I love you now. Matter of fact, I love you so much in your sin that I sent my son Jesus Christ down the cruel cross on Calvary. Isn't that the greatest?
Amen.
I'm going to tell you to go home and do homework because I'm going to skip over it, okay? So this is your homework. I want you to go home and read 2 Samuel 12, 1 through 12. 2 Samuel 12, 1 through 12. But this is how God's never done with us. And I had it. I was going to put it on the screen. I was going to read it because of time. I'm going to go ahead and move on. But God sends a man named Nathan, who is David's friend, to minister to him. Nathan tells him a story really about a rich man that stole the guy's one lamb. And David was so mad over this story that he goes, this guy ought to be killed. And Nathan looked at Saul and said, that man is you. You stole what didn't belong to you. And when Nathan began to minister to David, these are still the qualities that we can learn from David, the qualities that we want to have in our life. David realized his wrong. He repented of his sin. He asked for forgiveness. And then he became the man of God again that he was in the very beginning.
Amen.
But how many times do you hear people say, you're not going to start telling me what to do? I'll live my own life. I'll do my own thing. I'll play my own game. Get out of my face. Don't be telling me stuff like that. David listened. David knew. David repented. And he heard. I want to take you to one verse real quick as we close. I want to take you to Galatians chapter 6. And if you want to come up to the keyboard, I'm going to close with this. But in Galatians chapter 6, I think it is our key. And I believe this is what God is teaching us today as we look at the story of that being pickpocketed by the past. There is a God that can restore what has been stolen from us.
Amen.
There is a God that can give back what the enemy has taken. There is redemption in the name of Jesus and freedom in the name of Jesus. And in Galatians chapter 6, verse 1, it says this, brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in sin, that's the harshness of life. That sin is ugly, sin is painful, sin is, well, it's just disgusting, isn't it? I mean, really, it's just a disgusting thing. But so many times in our sin and in our problem and in these places that we find ourselves in, I think God raises the curtain and sometimes our sin is just revealed. It's just revealed and people see us for who we are. They see us for maybe going from that great person to that monster that has slid down a slippery slope like David was. But how often do people, how often do religious churches, didn't say righteous, I said religious churches, crucify the sin and crucify the sinner at the exact same time.
Yeah.
See, I don't condone sin one bit, but I love you enough to welcome you in this place no matter what you did last night. No perfect people allowed here. Come as you are, just don't leave as you came. Because we've saved a seat for you. Because there's a God that I know if you can get next to, He will change your life. He will redeem you. He will bring you back. He will give you freedom. He will put a smile back on your heart and on your face. He will give you a peace that passes all understanding. Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, put in the RIV, the Ronnie International version. Stop beating the hound out of them.
Yes.
Stop beating the hound out of them. There's enough harshness in the world without us who claim to be Christians adding to it. Our job is to lead people to the cross. Lead people back to the love of God. Lead people into His mercy and His grace. Lead them into a brand new understanding of who God has created us to be. God never created us to live in bondage. God never created me to be fearful 24/7. God created me to walk in freedom. He who the Son sets free is free indeed. I was going to say, you who live by the Spirit. Who is that? Come on now. Don't sit there and look at me like a cow looking at a new gate. Who are those who are led by the Spirit? Or somebody says, yeah, there you go. Who is it? Who? 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 That's me. That's me. It's what I'm letting God do in me. Led by the Spirit. Should do what? Restore that person brutally and harshly. Yeah. That's not it. That's not it. Come up here real quick. Yeah, I want to pick on you. Don't look at me like, come up here real quick. I'm going to close with this, I promise. But when Jesus, okay, I did that. Come up here, Jesus. Yeah, but when Jesus was going to Calvary, they took him before they got to Calvary. I'm going to have to bow down for just a minute, okay? And they put him on a stump, and they chained him to a stump, and relentlessly they began to beat Jesus into submission. So much so, the Word of God says that he was beaten beyond recognition of a man. Us Christians do that to each other.
Hello.
We find someone in sin, and instead of gently taking them to the cross, gently walking them, we beat the hand out of them.
Come on.
Religiously.
Real talk.
We slap them around. We beat the hand out of them. But this is what I love. Your sin is so horrible, and I'm so righteous, I'm going to slander your name to everybody I know. I'm going to slander your sin to everybody that's out there. I'm going to make the whole church know what you did, but I'm righteous, so I'm going to beat you into submission, because this is what I know. This is what righteous people do. If I can beat you down, I can lift me up, because I'm better than you are. Don't preach well, does it? So they took Jesus, and they were trying to beat him into submission. But the Word of God says he couldn't be recognized as a man any longer. You understand what I'm saying? Those who are led by the Spirit are to restore this person gently. But watch yourself. But watch yourself. Why? Because in beating him down, the Word of God says, you're going to be tempted to sin. And your slander, your mouth, your heart, your action, your head, your heart will not be any worse than the sin that you committed. But instead, I want to ask you to stand, and I'm going to kill myself, okay? Because this is what the Bible says, that we are to do what? Carry his burden. Okay? I'm going to put your hand in just a second. But I'm to carry his burden. Really? I'm to carry his sin. I am to carry his hurt. I am to carry his addiction. I am to carry his pain. I'm to carry his desire to want to come back to God. The Word of God says, I am not to judge him. The Word of God says, I am to restore him and do what? I'm to do it gently, and I am to carry his burden. That's just good stuff. That's just good stuff. And when we do that, it says, that's when we, who are led by the Spirit, That's when we, who have not religion, and we're not just religious, but we have a relationship that makes a difference. That's when we, who are led by the Spirit, are gently pulling them back in, working with them, carrying their burden. And this way, we fulfill the law of Christ. Thank God for Nathan that spoke into David's life. Thank God for Nathan that didn't back up. Thank God that Nathan didn't go into the king and try to crucify him because the king wanted to crucify him. But thank God that Nathan went in with a heart full of love and compassion. Loved him, carried his burden, and carried him back into the arms of a loving God who wanted to change his life. Would you stand with me? As we go to the Lord in prayer today, I believe this message was directly for somebody that's trapped. It was directly for somebody that you feel like you are on a slippery slope. I believe it was for somebody that you feel like you have maybe, because of an addiction, an action, a thought, or you have just turned out to be that person you didn't know you could be, that you find yourself now on a slippery slope to turn it into a monster. And as I've preached this sermon today, you just look at yourself and go, how did I get here? How did I get here? Never head bowed, nobody looking around. I know. Oh man, I know. Beyond a shadow of doubt that God wants to do something incredible in somebody's life. And I would never in a billion years, I want you to hear the heart of your pastor. I would never want to really embarrass you in any way, form, or fashion. Never. The intention of what I'm doing is really to say, I want God to do something incredible in your life. And I'm about to ask this church to do the absolute hardest thing that you will ever do in your entire life, to become vulnerable in front of people and in front of God. Oh man, that's such a painful place to be. And the enemy will tell you right now, don't do it, don't step out, don't say that you're weak. The enemy will tell you you can do this on your own, you don't have to do it in front of people. But I just know that God says, if you're ashamed of me, I'm going to be ashamed of you. And I'm going to do a very special altar call, and I'm going to ask you to do me a favor for just a moment, just reverently, very reverently. I'm going to ask you to keep your heads bowed, nobody looking around, because I'm going to try to make this as easy as I can. But if there's anybody here today that you feel trapped, and I don't have to go any further because you know exactly what I'm saying by that. You feel trapped, and you feel like today is your day that God is going to set you free. You know it in your heart because you feel the Holy Spirit tugging. I'm going to ask you to make the most bold step that you have ever done. Nobody's looking. It's just me, you, and God. Nobody's looking. But you may have to say excuse me to somebody. But I want you to come down here. And there's going to be a group of people in a moment that is going to pray with you, pray for you. But this is what we're going to pray. We're going to pray to be set free once and for all in the name of Jesus. If that's you, and the Holy Spirit is tugging at your heart, I'm going to ask you right now to come. Right now, come. There's an answer. There's an answer. Come. There's an answer. There is a God of second chances that's just begging to do something incredible. Chris. Alan. Steve, you you stood. Ed. As we're praying, I'm going to ask our congregation to do something. This is, in this series, it's so much feel like this identity theft is something that speaks to each and every one of our lives. Absolutely. But I want to talk to our congregation for a moment, and I want to talk to these men that are down front for just a moment. Do not believe the lie of an enemy who comes to kill, steal, and destroy. Do not do it. We serve a God that brings life and brings abundant life. And today, I believe this is what he's saying. If you've opened the door, if you've fallen into a place, a trap, if you're in a place of conviction, hurt, pain, some sorrow, I need you to understand this. God wants to turn this whole thing around for you. Amen? God wants to turn this thing around. God wants to set you free. Guys, I'm going to ask you to start praying like you've never prayed. If God lays it upon your heart to speak to these people, I want you to speak to these people, okay? Speak into their life. I want you to become an accountability partner to them while they're down here today. But don't let me pray for you. I want you to pray for yourself, okay? In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Father, today I give you each and every need that was represented in this altar. I give you every pain. I give you every hurt. I give you every addiction. I give you everything that drags us down. Father, today we give you every pain that holds us back. Father, today we give you everything that keeps us from getting closer to you and separates us from the very presence of a living God. Today, in the mighty name of Jesus, as we give it to you, we pray for absolute freedom in the name of Jesus. Freedom. Somebody needs to receive that in the name of Jesus. You need to tell the Lord, I receive your freedom. I receive your healing. God, I receive your understanding because I don't get it right now and I'm lost. Father, today I receive your presence. I receive your power into my life to change me from the inside out and to make me brand new. Today I give you this addiction. Today I just give it to you. I ask you to take it away. And today I pray that you'll clear my heart. I pray that you'll clear my mind. I pray today that you will clear me out, that you will clean me from the top of my head to the soles of my feet. Today is a day that I am calling out to these men that are in this altar. I am calling out that mighty man of God that is in you. That mighty man of God that God has placed within you from the very beginning of time. Today we are calling that thing out. We are calling that which doesn't look like it's there to existence. God, breathe new life into these men today. Mighty man of God, you will walk in wisdom. Mighty man of God, you will walk in integrity. Mighty man of God, you will walk in boldness. But more than that, you will walk in freedom because of what Jesus Christ is doing in your life. You need to receive it in the name of Jesus. Before you leave this place, if you come in here today and you do not know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, as they're praying and ministering, this is why we're here, so you can experience Jesus in the most radical, life-changing way ever. And if you come in this place today, if you do not know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I want to pray with you before you leave. If that's you, I'm not going to call you. I'm not going to call you down right now. Just where you're standing. Nobody's looking around. All the heads are bowed and people are praying. If that's you and you want to receive Jesus Christ in your life, I'm just going to ask you right where you're at to raise your hand. And I'm going to pray with you before you leave. I want to receive Jesus into my life. I want to receive Jesus into my life. Anybody here? Okay, we're not in any hurry to leave. Guys, I want you to pray with these guys as long as you need to pray with them. I am here till the sun goes down. If you need me here, I am here, okay? So just take your time. I'm going to pray a prayer of blessing over you guys. that during this series that God will unlock something in us, that we will get closer to Him. Amen? That it'll be life-changing. And by the power of God, we will be transformed into something incredible. I want to pray a prayer of blessing on you. Father, we love you. And Father, we praise you. And Father, I pray that in the name, the mighty name of Jesus, that as we dive into the first part of this study of identity theft, that you will help us to realize that even though the enemy comes into our life, you're bigger than anything he throws at us. And that in the name of Jesus, I can walk in freedom. So this is what I pray. This week will be a week of victory. This week will be my week that I take a stand for who I am in Christ. And I'll take a stand for my King who now lives in me. We pray for victory in the name of Jesus. We pray for freedom in the name of Jesus. And Father, I pray this week that as you bless us, that you will put a smile on our face and put a skip in our steps. We're going to be careful always to give you all the praise and the glory. Amen.